me fire, give me that which I desire.
So, sorry that this didn't come out last week because it was supposed to, but I was super sick. My wife was super sick all last week, and some kind of food poisoning. We really don't understand how we picked it up, but it is what it is. I mean, you survive. In a weird turn of events, though, so we also did this kind of fundraising 5K run on Saturday after my first real meal that I could eat, like, of solid food. It was Friday night dinner. Saturday morning, went for a run, and I medaled in my age group. So out of a 650 person event, apparently a person with a digestive illness is the third fastest, the second loser out of them all, so check that out. That happened, but anyways, what this video is about is the Boy Scouts changed their name and charter about 2 weeks ago, so this is even later coming out than I had hoped it would be. Because of me being sick, but I had some thoughts about it, and I think one of the things about this issue is that as a society, we have relegated certain institutions to the responsibility of training up young people, that parents no longer take that responsibility individually, but they've just kind of given it to certain of these organizations out there, and it's just their job now. And in the instance of things like character, integrity, responsibility, stuff like that, it is the job of the Boy Scouts or youth sports and public education to teach kids how to be good citizens, essentially. And we've seen the product of that coming out of the fact that kids are irresponsible. They're super liberal because public education is super liberal. They're showing the fruits of what we've wanted them to do, essentially. So, I think now that we have Boy Scouts, they've changed their name and charter where so that they're not offensive to girls or discriminatory against girls, and as a result you can mark off another one of those institutions of what are supposed to be good role models for young men in our society, leaving what I guess you could say, like, youth sports is really the one thing where you could send a young boy and expect them to come out with some sort of leadership or skills anymore. Apprenticeship is gone. There's really no anything else for it. So in response to that, what I want to give you people is a list of my top 3 media portrayals of a man, which is a good role model for guys in our society. Now, little bit of a caveat of there's obviously going to be no perfect illustration of what good manhood is in this list, because that doesn't exist. There's no such thing as a perfect man, unless you want to say, like, Superman. He's perfect, but at the same time, he's a terrible role model. His relationship with, like, Superboy, for instance, is that of what you could call a deadbeat dad, almost. Like, he's not a good male role model, and it's unrealistic and unattainable as well. So I mean even Batman with the Bat family, like, he's still not good. Like, you can see the way that Dick Grayson and the rest of the Bat family are, like, they're so dysfunctional and they're isolated and self-interest, like they're not healthy individuals either as the result of the mentorship that they've received from Batman. Number three for you is the sitcom dad. Well, and I kind of reached into just sitcoms in general. They're kind of a special category of media where they're actually trying to portray the way life is according to a specific set, or the way that this idealized or kind of caricaturized ideal of what a life is like for, say, research scientists in academia, or a broke college or kind of career professional in the city, or the whatever it is. Like, they specifically choose a set demographic and they're like, this is what life either is or should be, sort of, according to stereotypes. And a lot of them are mildly self-aware of the tropes and stuff that they're putting out there, and they purposely play on that. For this slot, the kind of sitcom dad, there was a lot that you could choose from of that are in their family men. They go to work every day. They come home every night. You got the Phil from Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, and you got Carl Winslow from Family Matters, and you got Dr. Huxtable, Bill Cosby, and like, you have several of them that are there. You've got the Matthews family from Boy Meets World, and but the one that I chose for this slot is a hybrid character, Tim Taylor from Home Improvement / Mike Baxter from Last Man Standing. And the reason I put a slash there is that he's the same character in both shows. The only difference is that Mike Baxter has three daughters rather than Tim Taylor having three sons. And they play a lot more on the age of Mike Baxter, because he's clearly older than his Detroit counterpart in Home Improvement. But I like him as a character because in the instance of Phil or Carl Winslow, they're kind of this, they're a perfect dad. Carl Winslow is a cop. He goes, he's this pinnacle of society. And then Phil is a, he's like an attorney and then a judge. And like, that, they're these perfect members of society. They live in these white castles almost. Like, they're perfect guys. Whereas Tim Taylor and Mike Baxter, they're not. They are doing pretty well. They're public personas. They have businesses that they run. They have families but that they care about and love. But honestly, like, the entire show is them on, like, they learn lessons. They make mistakes. They have to work on their relationship with their wives and with their children. And they do things that their kids then repeat back to them. And then they realize that that was a mistake, that they shouldn't have done that. And then, like, there's a lot of I'm sorries. There's a lot of growth and development over throughout the entire shows, where they're becoming, and they're going through midlife crises and stuff like that, that a lot of other shows that I just, honestly, I didn't see. Because, for instance, Boy Meets World, the show's not about the dad. He's only there as kind of a wise mentor more than he is anything else. And you don't see a lot of that focus on him as an, like, because that's the thing of that this show is about that dad. He's about, and him grappling with changes to society.
Why, send it in, what do you mean?
The faculty committee needs to approve it after they check for microaggressions.
Microaggressions, you mean like midget warriors?
They're objectionable words or phrases. For instance, midget warriors.
I know what microaggressions are. It's the latest liberal attack at free speech. And a lot of fun if you do them right.
The universe. university has a list of stuff they don't allow speakers to say, you know, to protect the students.
From what, ideas?
It's just the way that my school does things, Dad. Please, my grade is riding on this.
Fine. All right. Just pretend like you introduced me to thunderous applause. Some lady faints in the front row. Ladies and gentlemen.
Okay, stop.
No, they'll pick her up. Come on, EMS. Get her out of here.
No, you can't say ladies and gentlemen because it excludes those who don't identify as either.
But those are the only two choices.
No, not anymore. You just have to keep it gender neutral, okay? Please continue.
Hey, everybody. America's the land of opportunity. I stand before you
as... Stop. Okay, by saying that America's the land of opportunity, you are implying that everyone has the same opportunities.
I'm not implying it. I'm saying it. If you live here and you work hard, you can succeed. That's how this works.
Yeah, that one's on here, too. It hurts the feelings of those who work hard and don't succeed.
Here's a list of stuff that doesn't hurt people's feelings. That's got to be a short one.
You have no idea how seriously my school takes this stuff, Dad. And remember the greater good here. You're helping me scam my way to passing ethics.
This list is insane. If I go by these rules, I'll be going against everything I believe in.
I know, but just for 15 minutes. Thank you, Dad.
No. Can't call me Dad. What if I identify as Mom?
And changes to his family dynamic as his kids are growing up and dealing with, like, in Last Man Standing, his youngest daughter is rejected from West Point, and she's obviously heartbroken over that. And, like, it's tough as I'm seeing, like, she'd been working for that goal for the greater part of 2 seasons, I think, and there's nothing he could do about it. He just had to sit there and just let her suffer through the grief of that, and there's nothing, like, there's not really another show that displays that kind of family dynamic. And it shows how human he is. I mean, Tim Taylor blowing stuff up in the house, but trying to do things, right? A little bit more of the primitive caveman trope of what a dad or a man is. But on the other hand, like, it's just, I mean, good show, good guy. Like, he's somebody that you could clearly see that you would love to sit down, have a beer with if you wanted to. And you could really get to know him. Like, and you would actually know him as a person rather than this false portrayal of whatever, right? So that's my number 3. Tim Allen, honestly. Number 2 is still coming from kind of a family or an animated type, kid-friendly environment, but it's Earl Devereaux, who's the police chief.
What you doing, Flintlock Wood?
Just holding my hands behind my back respectfully, sir.
You know what you are, Flintlock Wood.
No.
A shenaniganizer. A Tom Fool.
Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs. And I like him as a character first because he's got the voice of Mr. T and Terry Crews in the sequel, like just two almost cartoons onto themselves. But I mean, Terry Crews seems like the type of guy that's as well, like, very human, normal, loves his wife. You can see that he loves his kids. Like, when you see the portrayal of the character on the show, that it's not as much of this artificial version of, but it's like, it's just a character of him himself. I mean, those Old Spice commercials and but he loves his son.
You see my beautiful angel son, Cal?
Sup?
I love him so much. This is my only son. I want him to have a bright future. A future in which you don't ruin our town's day with one of your crazy science doolibaba thingies.
And in a society where it's becoming increasingly hostile towards the idea of men showing emotion and having affection for their families or having affection for another male, like, it's awkward, and, like, a lot of them show it as this uncomfortable, like, that it should be either shied away from or whatever. Like, he very clearly says, I mean, he loves his son and he cares about him and he wants him to have this bright future and stuff. Like, and obviously, I mean, there's this disconnect of that they really don't understand each other very well, but it's okay because of the fact that they're family and they're going to get through it. That whole movie, honestly, is really great because it portrays the way that two generations have so much difficulty communicating with each other, with the Lockwoods, and that even still they're able to be productive and that they can show and they can bond together, and like, it's really great.
It's enough to make a grown man cry, but not this man. Get back in there, Tia.
Yeah, he's my number two, simply because like, it's not like, it's hard for a guy to be emotional in society, to show emotionality without getting hammered for it. And so when you see a character that is unashamedly affectionate towards his son and wanting to be involved in a society where fatherlessness and abandonment is so rampant, is, I mean, quite honestly, it's great.
You see this contact lens, Flint Lockwood? Mm-hmm. This contact lens represents you.
All right.
And my eye represents my eye.
Okay.
I got my eye on you.
Oh my gosh, a jaywalker.
Hey!
So, that's number two. Number one, by far my favorite male role model character in all of cinema, film, Hollywood history, comes from a show, this old movie with Haley Joel Osment, Michael Caine, and Robert Duvall called Secondhand Lions, which is a movie that I saw on VHS as a kid and honestly had no idea what it was about. I remember watching it at the end and like, I really didn't get it. I did not understand it at all. But then I watched it again as an adult, rented the DVD from a Red Box and watched it, and just, it blew my mind because I could remember having seen it, but I couldn't remember anything about it until I watched it. And I was like, it was so good at this kid whose mom just abandons him, offloads him onto these two old guys and just leaves him there. And that it's like these two guys are forced into the role of being a fatherly role model when they're just wanting to be crotchety old guys. Right, honestly, just retired old guys, and they're mentoring this kid and teaching him what it means to be a man.
Courage and manhood is to get together with a bunch of punk friends and ride around and irritate folks too good natured to put a stop to it.
Hey, who do you think you are, huh?
Just dumb kid, huh? Don't kill him.
And these young rowdy dudes, which tend to be kind of the antagonists in a lot of movies from the 80s and 90s, whether that's Kiefer Sutherland in Stand By Me or whatever, where they're just rowdy males. And he says, they ask him who he is, and he says, my name is Hub.
Hub McCann. I fought in two world wars and countless smaller ones on three continents. I led thousands of men into battle with everything from horses and swords to artillery and tanks. I've seen the headwaters of the Nile and tribes of natives no white man had ever seen before. I've won and lost a dozen fortunes. Kill many men!
Tells him exactly who he is, and it's nice to see where you have a person who is aware of himself and is aware of the things he's done, but the most dynamic thing that he remarks on that I have done as a human being is that I loved one woman.
And loved only one woman with a passion, a flea like you could never begin to understand. That's who I am.
And that, that's the thing about him, that like, this is the marker. So he's my favorite. He's such a great portrayal. Like, this is what manhood is. Yes, bravery, courage in combat, which is something that, I mean, just the willingness to take on and fight for convictions and for honor, and to honestly, and to take on young men and train them and to teach them and so forth. I mean, that's all great, but I mean, to stay committed to one woman for your entire life, and even past the bridge of her own life, where she's no longer in the picture. She passed away, but there's something unique about that portrayal in Hollywood that it just doesn't exist in today's society as much, and you're especially not going to start seeing those kind of values anymore now that things like the Boy Scouts have given themselves over to this liberal agenda that wants to do nothing but erode healthy masculinity and the simple idea of manhood. Let me leave you with that. That's three men in culture that if you look at, you can learn some good, honest, quality lessons from in 30 minutes to an hour and a half on a Saturday morning. And you would be better off for it, quite frankly. So if you like that, like, share, subscribe, comment. If you've got a male character or a female character, maybe I'll do a favorite female characters at some point in the future. If you guys are into that, you guys want me to make that, and I'll see you out there. Bye.